station. Broadcast on KNLS.
Anchor Point, Alaska, United States of America.
Our English language transmission starts in 1 minute.
And emergency preparedness and response programs around the world. Additional vehicles in March of 2020, the fund donated $5 million towards the COVID-19 response effort. Shelter is a lot in our home country of Barbados, especially in education. The only thing Rihanna has not done recently is put out her new work. Her last album was entitled Auntie, and it was released in 2016. Rihanna is absolutely one of a kind. Congrats for all her successes, and we can't wait to see what she'll do next. And I'm sure her music fans are hoping it's another album.
Now it's time for True Stories from the Bible in Contemporary English. Today's story begins with Jesus and his disciples still on the shore of Lake Tiberias. Jesus looked at Peter and asked, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than the others do? Simon Peter answered, Yes, Lord, you know I do. I feed my lambs, Jesus said. Jesus answered to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter answered, Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Then take care of my sheep, Jesus told him. Jesus asked a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus had asked him three times if he loved him. So he told Jesus, Lord, you know everything. You know I love you. Jesus replied, Feed my sheep. I tell you for certain, when you were a young man, you dressed yourself and went wherever you wanted to go. But when you are old, you will hold out your hands. Then others will tie your belt around you and lead you where you don't want to go. Jesus said this to tell how he has a God to bring honor to God. Then he said to Peter, Follow me. Peter turned and saw John following them and asked Jesus, Lord, what about him? Jesus answered, What is it to you if I want him to live until I return? You must follow me. So the rumor spread among all the disciples, and John would not die. Jesus did not say he would respond. He simply said, What is it to you if I want him to live until I return? Jesus did many other things. If they were all written in books, there would not be room enough in the whole world for all the books. This story is found in the Bible, Book of John, chapter 21. Next, on two stories from the Bible in contemporary English, we will hear about Jesus going back to heaven. Join us again for two stories from the Bible in contemporary English.
Rihanna gives us more of today's best music on your new life station.
We will never enjoy true success until we can achieve the big picture. My name is Steve Gibbs. I'm glad you're with us today. Today I want to talk to you a little bit about the four C's of great leadership. See, most of us are leaders. Some of us don't realize it, but most all of us lead in some context or another. Some of us are leaders in our business. Some of us are leaders at church. Some of us are leaders in other organizations that we're members of, but those of us that don't think of ourselves as leaders, the fact is there are people that are watching you, that are paying attention to what you're doing, and they aspire to be more like you. So, and that's just, as a leader, I'm going to give you a concept that has really helped me a lot. I call this the four C's of great leadership. Great leaders are great vision casters. You know, the Bible talks about this over in the book of Proverbs. The writer says, where there is no vision, the people perish. So as a great leader, how do you develop that vision? How do you develop the ability to cast a vision that other people will aspire to attain, that other people will want to achieve their own lives? Let me give you the four C's. Everything you do with the people that you lead needs to be very clear. Use clear words, words that people understand. And make sure that everything is simplistic enough that everybody in your listening group So it will help you with the content of what you're trying to communicate. So the first of these four C's is that we have to be core speakers. The second C is that everything we say should be concrete. In other words, we don't talk to people that we're meeting in ways that can be easily misunderstood. If you want to ask someone to do a job, be specific. If you're not specific and the person does not do what you want them to do, that individual is not to blame. You're to blame. The third C is to be concise. In other words, don't overload other individuals. Be simple, be to the point. Don't use more words than necessary. You know, a lot of people get accused of using 10 words when they can just as easily use 5. We don't need to use extra words. We simply need to speak to them in a way that is concise, that they understand. And number four, we need to present it in a compelling way. In other words, we need to help other people catch the vision. We need to communicate in ways that make other people want to do what we want them to do. You know, there's an old saying. They say, how do you get sold about a boat? Well, one thing you don't do, you don't bring them a bag of meals and a bunch of lumber and say, build a boat. Well, most people aren't going to respond to that. But on the other hand, when you take them out to sea, when you show them the beauties of the sea, then they'll want to sell the boat. In other words, show the person, let that individual understand in a compelling way, why this is good for that individual. You see, anytime we cast a vision, that vision should help the individual align and refine their thinking. Well, my name is Steve Diggs. This has been the Big Picture. I want to invite you that if you don't already know Jesus, why don't you come to me? We ought to know him. Write us at radio@knls.org. Hey, I'm Steve Diggs. This has been the Big Picture. I'll see you next time. Ciao.
We want to make God proud available to anyone who wants. We have a Bible in easy-to-read English version. You can get one free of charge. Just write to us by postal mail to KNLS, P.O. Box 473, Anchor Point, Alaska, 99956, USA. Or email us at radio@knls.org. Your favorite songs from today's best music. This is your new life station.
Let's get into the music. Here's Tom Hammond. When you have an encounter with someone, it can either be good or bad. Once you had an encounter with Jesus, it was amazing. Red Sound shares their stories with us on Encounters with Jesus. If you have children, you've likely had this experience. From a child, say it's a boy.
It's about 5 years old.
You have him with you in a crowd of people, perhaps in a shopping area.
He's old enough that you don't probably must hold his hand every minute because
he uses things close to you.
But all of a sudden, he's gone.
You look here, you look there, and he's not around any place.
So you start asking the people with you, have you seen Johnny? He was right here. And suddenly he's gone.
Well, however,
you find him.
He probably has stopped to look in the window of a shop with puppies, chocolate, or something else interesting. Therefore, you give him a little reminder that he's supposed to spoil with you. And you hope this doesn't happen again. Whether that's happened to you or not, you can imagine what that parent must have been feeling. A similar story occurs in the Bible. When Jesus was 12 years old, he went with his parents to a Passover festival in Jerusalem.
thousands of people annually for the Feast of Passover. When children are home, they customarily stay home with their mothers. At age 12, boys celebrate a bar mitzvah. A bar mitzvah means a sign of the covenant. It was a sort of dedication ceremony, reminding young men that they must enter Jews in the religious life of the Jewish community. If you know any Jewish families, you are familiar with the words bar mitzvah. It's called bat mitzvah for, let's say, 12-year-old girl, but it's the same sort of thing. We don't know whether Jesus had a bar mitzvah or not. Still, age 12 would be the time to accompany the crowds to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. The festival lasted a week, and everybody would return home. As they were making their way home, suddenly Mary and Joseph looked around. And Jesus was not in sight. I just assumed he was with friends and relatives headed for Nazareth or home, but he wasn't to be found even by nightfall. Well, of course, there was nothing to do but for them to turn around and head back to Jerusalem. For 3 days, and you can imagine how frantic they went again by this time. Eventually, they thought of looking in the temple courts where they celebrated the Passover, and then he was. But he wasn't alone. He was with the officials and teachers from the temple, blessing them and interacting with them. The Bible says everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. For a 12-year-old, Jesus seemed to have an unusual perception of the religious laws and customs. The rabbinic way of teaching involved questions and answers. Rabbis or teachers would ask questions, then the young men would answer as best they could. The older men were surprised by Jesus' precise knowledge. If you had been Jesus' parents, what would you have heard? Precisely what Mary and Joseph were. They listened to their conversation and both were astonished. But before long, Mary could resist asking, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." To that, the first question would be, "Son, why don't you call us on your cell phone?" But no, Jesus lived 2,000 years ago, no cell phones. Jesus' answer seemed to imply that he and they were living on different planets. "Why were you searching for me? Did you know I had to be in my father's house?" Whoa, apparently they've been shaking their heads for sure. So, it's no surprise that the following words in the Bible were, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. And I'm sure that's right. But of course, they knew that Jesus was a remarkable young man. Apparently, at the ripe age of 12, Jesus was becoming conscious of his own identity. Moreover, he was becoming deeply aware of a more extensive duty beyond his home, Nazareth. Even so, it is incredible to read the following words. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. Jesus was beginning to register that some extraordinary things lay ahead. But he also knew that he was only 12 years old and still had a responsibility to obey his parents. The last verse of this section of the Bible reads, "And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature, and in favor with God and men." As we go further, these encounters with Jesus from week to week, we begin understanding what those words mean. In the meantime, give some thought to Jesus' response to his mother. "Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?"
And you're listening to Plug Bands.
What age should I get my kid their first smartphone?
It's the most common question I've asked at my parent workshops. And the answers in the summer?
The summer before high school, when they're filled with dial-up or becoming screen-wise.
And I'd always think of the second most common question I've asked. What if I already gave my 10-year-old a 12-year-old a phone?
Great question. And my first word of advice is,
don't hold on, I can just get away.
Instead, do two important things.
One, begin the conversations you should have had before you gave them the phone. That summer filled with conversations about becoming streamlined. And two, lobotomize the phone.
Yeah, it's not so much what to block as what to allow.
Block everything but a few approved apps.
So use a strong password required to download any app.
From one of those screens in your Kickstarter.
Visit us at platform.com/radio.
I'm Jonathan McKee, author of Parenting Generation Screening,
where focus on the family is plugged in.
Here's One Republic on your new life station.
Gun violence in the U.S. has long been a problem, and now a group of religious leaders is taking the problem to national leaders.
The Reverend Rob Shank is president and founder of the Detect Your Improper Institute.
He's part of this effort. Joins us now from the nation's
capital. Reverend Shank, thank you so much for joining us today.
My pleasure.
Is gun violence a spiritual issue?
Very much so.
Oh, that's a lot. Cheryl kicks us into the music on your
New Life Station.
You're inspired. They foretell the future. And they're very much about us. The promises of God, the subjects of this series. The author, Will Randy. Your host, Royce Kessler.
In the New Testament section of the Bible, we have four accounts of the life of Jesus Christ. These books are called the Gospels. This word means good news. One of those four accounts is called the Gospel of Luke. In the last chapter of this book, Jesus told his disciples that all prophecies concerning him in the Old Testament must be fulfilled. The prophecy in the Bible was an inspired depiction of some coming event. The word inspired means that the message came from God. One of the last things Jesus told his followers was that everything that had been written about him hundreds of years before in the Old Testament must actually happen. This included all of the statements from the Law of Moses, the writings of the Old Testament prophets, as well as the Psalms. One of these prophecies about Jesus is found in the Old Testament book of Isaiah. When Jesus began his ministry, he went home to the city of Nazareth in Israel to attend a synagogue service on the Sabbath day. The synagogue was the place where Jews met to worship. When they asked Jesus to read a passage from the Jewish scriptures, he chose last in Isaiah and took the ministry he was about to begin. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to the captives, to give sight to the blind, relieve the oppressed, and proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. When we read this statement by Jesus, we can see how pertinent his ministry was to be for the lives and experiences of suffering of every day. First, Jesus said he was to preach God's good news to those who are poor and downtrodden. Next, he promised to free those who were in prison, whether prisons of stone or prisons in silence and force and fear. Third, Jesus offered to restore sight to the blind, which he often did during his ministry on earth. He would relieve the suffering of the oppressed. And finally, he would proclaim the year of the Lord's favor as he revealed God's plans for the future. In other words, what we find is Jesus himself in the body person. When God made human beings, he created us to be spiritual, emotional, physical, social, and intellectual beings. He created us to be capable of thinking, feeling, loving, hoping, and making decisions for the future. Jesus claimed for himself that he was the answer to all these needs. This is why these sayings we're starting to call the promises of Jesus are so important. The promises of Jesus are offered to everyone who will trust God. As we proceed from week to week, we shall show how Jesus met all the needs of the people with whom he came in contact. And still today, it will be the same for you and me. As we begin this study about promises, it would be good to remind ourselves of the doctrine of promise. When we were children, our parents promised to give us things, take us places, and do things with us. If they made a promise, they would do it to the best of their ability. We knew we could believe them when they made promises. God, our Father, is the same way. He has promised us many things that will enrich our lives. Not all our wishes and desires will be granted. But he has promised to bless us if we trust him. He knows our needs better than we do ourselves. His desire for us is to be truly happy and depend on him for everything. It gives God great pleasure to pour out his blessings upon us. And when God promises, we know he will fulfill those promises. Thank you.
It may be traditional, it may be contemporary, but it always has a message. Neil Pro joins us now for Reformation Christian Music, featuring a selection of great Christian music.
Are we? Your sandwich should be on your way. You realize that it was only a little over 700 years ago that the sandwich was invented. Tradition says that the early sandwich, back in April, was the first person to create a sandwich. I find that amazing. You would have guessed that back in primitive days, somebody would have realized that instead of eating meat with their hands, they could take 15 pieces of bread and it would be a whole lot neater. Maybe they didn't consider such things like this. The song you heard last year is constructed by the sandwich. First and third verses celebrate strength from goodness to sacrifice. His love, his righteousness, and the amazing gift of his life for the past and the future. But then the next verse, like the inside of the sandwich, is about weak, faltering human beings who need the greatness of a Savior. Listen as the group lad sings, "Before the throne of God above."
There's no place quite like home, although science continues to try and disprove that assumption. Spots got it right. We'll explain on today's Creation Moment. And now at Creation Moment's host, Paul Taylor.
Secular astronomers have defined a region around each star, a certain star habitable zone. It is in this zone that it is assumed that life as we know it could exist. The closer the planet is to its star, the higher its average temperature would be, unless there are other factors, like the runaway greenhouse effect on Venus. On planet Earth, life depends on liquid water, but the liquid phase of water actually has quite a narrow temperature range compared to many other liquid phases, just 100 degrees on the Celsius scale, or 180 degrees on the Fahrenheit scale. If the planet is too close to its star, cold water will be steam, but if it is too far away, it will be ice. In fact, there is only a narrow circular valley that will be in the liquid phase. And this is the second star habitable zone, or CHZ. Not too cold and not too hot. The CHZ is often popularly called the Goldilocks zone, after the little girl in the nursery rhyme, who, on trying to perish belonging to the bear, found one bowl too hot, one bowl too cold, but the other bowl just right. It is assumed then that water can be transmitted to liquid in the Goldilocks zone, whereas matter lies similar to that on the Earth could evolve. Astute listeners will realize what this is all kind of presuppositional. God, who proves that it is the Earth that is inhabited, does not appear to have faced life anywhere else. No amount of water at the right temperature can cause to appear what only God can create.
Creation Moments reveals the science that supports biblical creation. Visit us at creationmoments.com or call 1-800-422-4233. This next time, we'll be able to bring evidence for God's truth.
Your new life station brings you new music.
Take me crazy, Cloudy.
BTS with permission to do. New music from your new life station.
New Life Station, a part of your Tuesday. The English Hour is currently broadcast. If you're in the Pacific Rim, you can hear us best on 96.95 and 800 hours UTC. At 1000 hours and 1400 hours, you can hear us best on 95.8. And at 1200 hours, you can hear us best on 73.55. 5 or 9.95. If you're in India or anywhere in Southwest Asia, you can hear us best on 13.15 at 200 hours. I'm Rob Scobie. Join us again tomorrow for your new life station, English Hour.
We leave you the weekend on Grinding Life.